Good evening.
All right.
So welcome to East Los Angeles College in wonderful scenic Monterey Park for tonight's Unheard LA. Everybody good? Everybody doing good?
Yeah, okay, we're good.
We're good. I'm Ashley Alvarado, Director of Community Engagement at KPCC.
And I'm John Cohn, Managing Producer of KPCC in person. We're kind of warmed up a little bit in public radio. We like to do polls and surveys. So with a round of applause, how many of you are KPCC listeners? Excellent. Thank you for listening.
So here's the question that gets me excited. How many of you are attending a KPCC event for the first time?
It's always fun, too, when there's more people at our events than actually listen. I try to tell the broadcast folks that all the time, and they never believe me for some reason. We're here because Southern California is full of untold stories, but even more that go unheard.
And so we launched Unheard LA last spring to help change all that. It started with an invitation to you, our fellow Angelenos, to share your authentic first-person experiences of life in Southern California. And thanks to the overwhelming response we've received, we're back with more Unheard LA, Real People Amplified.
Now, each show is unique because of who's involved and where we are. And some of our folks, they're experienced storytellers. Many are not. And for some, this is the first time they've either ever been on stage or ever done any kind of public speaking. KPCC is a non-advocacy, non-partisan media organization, and tonight's show is reflective of the range of voices, experiences, and perspectives of our courageous participants and reflective of Southern California. Together, we explore our region one story at a time.
None of this would be possible without the California Wellness Foundation and California Humanities, a nonprofit partner of the National Endowment for the Humanities. Thank you for supporting this project. We'll be back with two more shows starting August 25th in Lawndale and September 23rd in Long Beach. To learn about those and our Unheard LA Story Salons, two of them happening next week, please visit our site, kpcc.org/unheardla.
Where you can find out how you can be involved and come up on our stage.
And we do invite you to engage with us on social media. We're at KPCC in person on Twitter and Instagram, and we're using the hashtag UnheardLA.
Enough of us. No show would be complete without a host, so please join me in welcoming Native Angelino, Artistic Director of Watts Village, Associate Artistic Director of Cornerstone Theater Company, and your Unheard LA host, Bruce Lemon.
Hello, LA. Welcome. Welcome to Unheard LA Live from Monterey Park. I am Bruce Lemon, your host, an amateur astronomer, a Chuck Taylor aficionado.
Sweet gold, right?
Yeah. And I have KPCC socks on. So that's got nothing to do with anything. I want to show you my socks. Just that. That's that. Well, I'm here to guide you through this evening and, most importantly, take advantage of all this air conditioning. Yeah, we don't have this at home. So thank you for choosing to spend the day here, beating the summer heat in here with us, sharing some space, sharing some stories. Anybody here for their first Unheard LA? Ooh, a lot of newcomers. Welcome to the family. How about some regulars? Who's been here before? With us before? Nice. All right, now where's everybody from? On the count of three, can we just shout them out, just rep your city? All right, one, two, three, go. Okay, let's try it again, one more time. One, two, three, go. Woo, I hear a couple of them. We are from all over the place. Woo, I am loving this growing community and I am blown away by the achievements and the experiences of the people that are brave enough to grace this stage and share their story with us. It's our moment to connect, our time to know your worth, to tell your story, because you never really know who needs to hear it. For instance, I'm not really one to advocate violence, but when I was cornered on the playground as a kid, I sure wished I had the skills of a prize pugilist. A little bit of training, I could have had class. I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody. Like our first storyteller. Please welcome Ty Fance.
I grew up in a poorer section of Northeast Houston. My childhood friends would describe me as a nice guy with a winning smile. Not an alpha male, more like a beta or a beta plus. Because when it came to physical confrontation, I'd rather talk it out, you know, maybe laugh about it or run. Picture this. I was 17 years old, lean, with a slight athletic build and an 18-inch afro. When my mom, with rollers in her hair and smoking a Winston Light, says to me, "Boy, we gotta move to a safer neighborhood and with better job opportunities." So a month and a half later, we packed up and moved from a two-bedroom, one-story house in Houston to a two-bedroom upstairs apartment in Watts. Right there on the corner of 91st and Central, where I was teased, chased, and worked up on a daily basis by this neighborhood bully named Gary. Right across the street, though, from our apartment, there was this free boxing program. Matter of fact, I signed up right away. And so did Gary. To my surprise, boxing came natural to me. I was good at it, man, in the gym. And my left jab was snappy and strong, and my left hook was quick and powerful. But my best punch was my uppercut. See, because I would set that up really nice with a jab, and then I would dip to the right, and I would throw that beast. Gary didn't like boxing, too many rules. But I loved it. And I would beat Gary round after round. And then right after class, I would scurry home. I remember one time I hit Gary so hard in his stomach, he had to take a knee right before he actually threw up his lunch. He was mad. He was like, "Man, I'm gonna kick your butt, man. You made me throw up my chicken McNuggets, man." That particular class, I left early. Boxing, wow. Boxing made me feel great. I was full of confidence, testosterone, and hope. As a matter of fact, I said, I could probably do this for a living. So I told my boxing coach, Andy. At the time, he was a professional boxer in his late 20s. His name was Andy the Hawk Price. I said, "Coach, man, take me to the real gym. Yeah, you know, where you train. Oh, man, I need some new time. I need competition. I need the real deal. I'm ready for the real deal." So the next day, he carried me to the right? The next day, we arrived at the Hoover Street Boxing Gym right there in L.A. near the corner of 78 and Hoover. Man, I got in that room and my eyes darted all the way around that worn-out gym. In the center was this crown jewel of a full-size four-posted boxing ring. And to the left, there was this big shirtless dude in his 20s with muscles on top of muscles, man, blasting away at the heavy punching bag, just going boom, 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 with every punch, every powerful punch, small clouds of dust would come off the bag, and these beads of sweat would just jump off his brow. And the whole building actually shook. Now, I was thinking, if I left right now and be out the door down the street, no one would even notice. And at that moment, I actually unconsciously reached out and grabbed Coach by his hand. He looked at me with a little concern and asked me if I was doing okay. Well, I couldn't really talk, though, because fear had made me temporarily mute. I reluctantly changed into my boxing clothes. Then Coach told me to choose a sparring partner. I carefully looked around the gym. Man. Every boxer in there was in such ridiculously great shape. Six-pack abs, chiseled pecs, piston-like muscles on their arms. Fortunately, in the corner, I saw this little dude that was over there, about my age. He was shadow boxing by himself, man. Ridiculously bad technique. Actually pathetic, I'll be honest with you. So I told Coach, I said, "I'll fight that guy. Yeah, that guy over there with the lime green pants on, I'll fight him. Yeah, the powder blue headgear, that guy. Yeah, with the fluorescent pink boxing gloves, I'm gonna fight that guy. Yeah, I'm sure, that guy." Don't worry about it. I'll take it easy on him. All right. So we get in the ring, me and Lime Green, and I hear the bell. Ding! And I just get going. I throw out a left. One. A second. And a third. And all three of my punches smash into this dude's face, causing his head to snap back. Boom! 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 My confidence quickly went from a -3 to a +5. I pinned him in the corner, too, and I threw a couple of punishing combinations to his head and stomach. Now, with my confidence in the max, I decided to stick that left hand out. Whoop-pow. Then I dipped to my right to unleash that beast. And right when I was about to do that, I began to be pummeled by bruising punches from these pink gloves. One punch after another, man, just boom, 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 and it got faster and faster and faster, faster, to a point where it felt like I was in a fight with the Tasmanian devil. We were spinning. Dirt and debris flew all around us, and every once in a while, a random object would stick out, like an arm, a leg, you know, an anvil. And every time I tried to escape from my self-inflicted nightmare, a tiny pink glove would reach out and grab me by my collar and pull me back in. Hell, I forgot all about my jab and my uppercut. I just started flailing my arms. Then everything slowed down. And Lime Green snapped my head back with a jab. And he dipped to his right and caught me with an uppercut right on my chin that sent me flying. I don't know what happened after that. But when I woke up, I could only see out of my right eye, right? And I panicked. But I realized what had happened is my headgear had turned around. And I was looking through the right ear hole. So I adjusted my headgear, and I struggled to get up. And once I got up, I wobbled around for a little while. And then I heard the bell ring, and it kept ringing. Then Coach called me, and I looked in the direction of the voice, and he said, did you want any more of the real deal? I smiled at him as I politely unlaced my gloves. I said, not today. You guys can have this crap. I'm going to college.
LA, Hollywood, Tinseltown. Welcome to the land of make-believe, where sometimes things are so wild that only those of us who have been here a while can tell you it's actually true. Please welcome to the stage, Kate Romero.
It was the mid-1990s, and I was at the old Nucleus Nuance Supper Club on Melrose to see Harry Dean Stanton's band. I loved to hear him play, and we had struck up a casual friendship. One night, after his show, we sat at the bar and shot the breeze about life, love, the movies, and while Harry Dean smoked cigarettes and drank dry martinis with a twist, an olive, and an onion, our conversation somehow turned to arm wrestling, and he challenged me. Now, Harry Dean wasn't a very big guy, and he'd had more martinis than either one of us could count. And he also had no idea that at the time, I held a world title in arm wrestling. Harry Dean put his arm up, we locked hands, and I just about pulled him off his bar stool. He shrieked, "Dang it, girl! Where'd you get those muscles?" And that's when I told him that I'd been raised on a farm with no running water, with wood stoves for cooking and heat, and how it was my job to draw the water with a pulley and a bucket from the well for a family of nine every day, and that I'd baled hay and carried in cords of wood from age 9 to 16, too. I didn't think that anything could impress Harry Dean at his age and with all of his life experiences, but my arm wrestling did. I told him about my world title, and we arm wrestled and laughed until 4 in the morning. Harry Dean invited me out to a dinner club the next night. When he came to the door of the restaurant to greet me, Rick James came running up from his white stretch limo, shouting to Harry Dean while towering over him, "Mr. Stanton, Mr. Stanton, my mama loves you, Mr. Stanton. Would you do me the great honor of giving me your autograph and addressing it to her?" Harry Dean said in true Harry Dean style, "Son, you don't want my autograph. You want this here girl's autograph. She got a world title in arm wrestling, and I'd bet you can't beat her." I was wearing a pretty pink polka dot dress with a scoop neckline and puffy cuff sleeves with a skirt that opened like an umbrella when I spun around. And I was dressed for a club, not a match. But before I could talk him out of it, Harry Dean had challenged Rick James to an arm wrestling match with me. It wasn't just Rick's cockiness that made me cringe. I'd read the terrible allegations about him and his abusive track record with women. Rick said to Harry Dean, "What do I get if I beat this cream puff?" Harry Dean said, "The winner gets $100. Being called a cream puff by this man made me shake with adrenaline. I said, "What you get if you beat me is you get to say that you beat a woman." He gave his 24-person entourage a look, and Harry Dean went inside the bustling club to clear a table for the match. The place was packed, and when people saw what was happening, you could hear a pin drop. Nearly salivating that he'd gotten his hero, Harry Dean's, attention, Rick plopped down in a booth opposite me, put his arm up to grab my hand, and when I gripped his hand, I saw his eyes bug out just a little. Harry Dean assumed the position of referee and shouted, "Go!" The crowd went wild, rooting for me to kick Rick's behind. Ooh, and I wanted it bad. After we pulled and pulled back and forth, I took Rick down with a loud thud. He immediately screamed that I had cheated by putting my breast in his hand, which I had not done. Being a lady, I gave Harry Dean a wink and said, "Harry Dean, it's okay. Let's go again, just to be sure." By this time, I knew Rick's lack of technique and where his weaknesses were. Harry Dean shouted, "Go!" And we went at it again. This time, I kept my upper body as far away from him as I could. And down went his hand with an even louder thud. I was the clear winner, and Rick did not seem to know how to deal with that. Harry Dean shouted, "Pay the lady!" Rick pulled his pockets inside out and said he didn't have any money. So Harry Dean went around to all 24 of his entourage and had them pull their pockets inside out until he counted out exactly $100, and he presented it to me. I scooped up the ones, fives, tens, and a 20 and stuck it all in my purse. That's when Rick did something unexpected, unpredictable. He said, "I like you." And he asked if I would honor him by being his VIP guest at an underground dance party nearby. Since he'd lost like a gentleman, I agreed, but only if he adhered to my conditions. One, I don't do drugs, and I won't do drugs. Two, you don't touch me unless I say you can. Three, you have your driver bring me back to my car whenever I'm ready, even if you're not ready for me to go. Deal? He put out his hand and we shook on it, and off we went. The party was what I thought it would be. Lots of drugs, half-naked people, alcohol flowing way after hours, people getting their freak on. No judgment, just wasn't my scene. I gave Rick the signal, and he gave me a respectful hug, and off I went in his white stretch limo to get my car and go home. The next day, I let my son stay home from school so I could treat him to lunch, movies, and a video arcade until every penny of that $100 was spent on my boy, who was my reason for living. Only in LA.
I am not picking a fight with her. I've read that Monterey Park is one of the best places to live in Southern California, right? Good location, great schools, and it made me think about all the places people pass through before they found this one, before they decide that this is it, before they know that this is home. Here to share his story, please welcome Corey Best-Kept Kofor.
Relocation plagued us like common colds. My mama worked the system. 30-day eviction notices turned 60, turned 90. First and last month rent deposit standard, $25 credit check fees, we had no chance. Money talks, my mama would say. A wad of 90 days of saved cash, reliable references and her beautiful smile usually got us a roof and at least four walls in our apartment, our home. The smell of hot water cornbread and salmon croquettes. Goulash and top ramen were common and black-eyed peas and grilled cheese with ease. Catfish go nice with dirty rice, iced tea on warm nights, greens, mustard, turnip, collard. Mama worked seasonal at the cannery, blue collar, our scholar. And we would watch 227 from apartment 227. And we upstairs, close to the heaven, staring at the houses across the way with the big old backyards. But there was something to be said about the softness of new carpet under my big toe and the aroma of new paint when moving into a new apartment. And there was something to be said about sanitary swimming pools deeper than 6 feet and calm neighbors and green landscape and trim bushes aching the $5 haircuts that stay straight across and quaint patios that stare at the moon and a walk-in closet big enough for a twin mattress. And there was something to be said about dirty reused carpet, crunchy to the touch, and moldy showers and tan color-stained toilets, and kids jumping rope right above where you sleep, and stubborn heaters on cold nights, and adult men fighting with their shirts off. It used to be a landscape, but now people just escape from apartments, where words like hills and ranch and view and gardens rarely lived up to their names. Vista View Apartments. Ain't no vista, ain't no view, and that show ain't no vista of no view. These words were to attract those who couldn't afford to live in the hills, or who had no backyard to plant a garden, or whose view was the neighbor's living room. You see, we once lived in the lowest part of the city, called The Heights. The Heights. The only heights about it were the bars that surrounded it. The Heights. A place where little black boys slang little white rocks with little fear. And gangsters wore corduroy house shoes with socks and dark skin made tattoos green. And girls carried their boyfriends' drugs and dared male cops to search them. A plethora of people got beat up or killed at the Heights. You can hear the hoarse voice of the ambulance siren as petite sisters cried at their brothers' funerals. And how yellow tape blocked parking stalls, barking dogs when they said no pets. We ready and we set and we're blowing with the wind. U-Haul truck shucks, we're at it again. Say goodbye to another friend. Say hello to another school. Say goodbye to another friend. Say hello to another school. Say goodbye to another friend and say hello to another school. Acting like we cool and we stable. Free cable and mom's old kitchen table, we keep that intact. We keep that in rap cassettes on deck. These are the breaks, Curtis Blow said it best. Me and my bro, we verbatim from the chest. Hotels before we gone. Searching for the next apartment we can call home.
You are what you eat, and see, and breathe, all that you experience. Now, there are many ways to process the experiences that make you you, to heal from trauma, to express yourself. Artists like Mr. Cartoon write on walls and flesh. Simon Rodia built the watchtowers with his hands. Tupac wrote. Lucky for us, our next storyteller does too. Please welcome to the stage, Macabeo Manzo.
My story begins in a small two-bedroom apartment where I hung on to methods that allowed me to survive until adulthood. My lovely parents modeled for me that being connected to your emotions was a path that you just don't venture on. My father taught me that in order to get your way, shutting down the lines of communication, and most importantly, being violent was a key to success. My mother taught me that in order to get your way, stepping outside of the relationship and only considering your ego was the prize at the end of the rainbow. So I took these values with me and instilled them in every significant relationship that I had. And as I was raised in South Central LA and fed a steady diet of violence, racism, and gangs, I didn't imagine a future, at least not one outside of gang life or the violent cycle I experienced at home. Being in a gang opened the doors for me so that I no longer could get bullied by my parents or by my peers at school. I grew tired of being afraid, and I simply wanted everyone to see me for who I was, a young child that needed nurture and love. I was engulfed in the traumas of the city, but through poetry and acceptance, I found release. And I found a way to channel my journey in a healing direction. The white shoelaces, the bruises with no traces, a man with boy-like needs, a boy with man-like seeds, walking through the halls, wondering if I had the balls to stand up to my enemy, because there was a little death inside of me. And I think of my father abusing my mother, and I think of my child self, and I think of my wild self. Growing up in a state of pity, I survived because suicide sounded gritty. And my neighbor took care of me. She threw me on the bed and molested me. My dad ignored my persona. My mother only drank Corona. My teacher told the girl in class to hit me in the face with all her mass. And I grew up disliking women. And in revenge, I pushed out venom because I was angry at the fact that my innocence was cracked. And I vowed to never let another disappear like my mother. And I vowed to never let another control me like the neighbor. So I went on a mission to destroy all women. And in the process, I fell in love. In the process, I fell above. But I was being two-faced it, and I found myself wasted off the alcohol drinking, sinking, in my mind thinking, how can I feel such hate? And how can I feel such debate? I never understood the reason for the rage in every season. And I came to the conclusion that I was in collusion in the continuous womanly violence, but I loved with my heart in silence.
I don't know if you noticed, but there are well over 100,000 actors in Los Angeles. With more moving here every day in hot pursuit of fame and fortune, or just a chance to create. Some skyrocket to fame, some land at home, some host community-driven storytelling shows. And some just float somewhere in the atmosphere. Please welcome to the stage our next storyteller, Russ Figa.
My dream of success started with playing the Cowardly Lion in the first grade production of The Wizard of Oz in White Plains, New York. I went on to play Kurt Von Trapp in The Sound of Music, Uncle Sam in a traveling tribute to the 1976 Bicentennial Celebration, and a busboy in a film called Used Cars. That last one is how I earned my SAG card, and it's what inspired me to move to New York City, where I did theater, improv, and yes, I waited on a lot of tables. Now, New York is fun. If you have money, I didn't. So one summer I went to visit a friend in Sedona, and that summer turned out to be 3 years. But ultimately, it was a small town, and my dreams were bigger. So I headed west, still a young man. I arrived in Los Angeles in 1985, and one of my very first jobs was delivering press releases for a TV show based on Groucho Marx. I got the job by dressing up like Groucho and doing a pretty decent impression for the job interview.
Why, this job is an outrage. If I were you, I wouldn't take it.
But I took it. And as I was driving around making my deliveries in my 1978 Volkswagen Rabbit with no air conditioning, it broke down in the middle of La Cienega and Wilshire Boulevard. So there I was out in the middle of the street. You know, I'm dressed like Groucho. It is hot as hell. I've got all the attire. My grease mustache and eyebrows are melting. And people are driving by laughing and yelling, "Hey, Groucho, what's the secret word? Tow truck!" But my first real success came when I learned that Murder, She Wrote was casting a pizza delivery guy. So I went to the casting director's office. Yeah, went to the casting director's office with a pizza box saying I had a delivery. And sure enough, the receptionist took it into the casting director. And instead of a pizza, he got my picture and resume. And I got the job. So, you know, I still get $10 residual checks for Murder, She Wrote. I mean, I swear to God, I think it's shown in every country that has a TV. I believe it's a law, actually. While pursuing my acting, though, I had crossed over to do something else where I could make more consistent money. A friend of mine was a location manager here in Los Angeles, and one day he asked me if I'd go take some photos of a house. Now, I'm an avid photographer, so it was pretty thrilling for me to get paid for doing something I actually like doing. And he liked my work. He hired me as his assistant, and you know, even though I was working behind the scenes, I was still in the business that I loved. And it didn't take long for me to work my way up and become a location manager. A location manager is not something I'd even thought about when I came out here. I'm an actor. The realization, though, that I was not going to have quite the acting career I'd hoped for occurred one day when I drove 2 hours to the west side of town to audition for some crime show. I was reading for the role of gang member number 5, as I recall. Okay, so there's one line in this scene, all right? The cop says, how many were in the car? 3. That's a line. That's it. Just one line, okay? So now, imagine a room full of people that look remarkably similar to you, and they're all saying the same line. Well, it's not even a line. It's a number, 3, all right? How many different ways can you see the number 3? You know, I mean, some guys are doing it with accents. One guy's in Spanish. Finally, guy holds up his hand, 3 fingers. He gets the job. So about that location managing. You know, it's a difficult and sometimes thankless job, but I was fortunate early on to work with Christopher Nolan on his first movie here in Los Angeles, Memento. And yeah, it was a lot of fun, and he and I spent a lot of time together at the iconic Johnny's Coffee Shop on Wilshire. And now this was before cell phones were ubiquitous, so we actually spoke to one another. And at one point I asked him, I said, Chris, there's this role of a waiter, and I was wondering if I could audition for it. And he let me. And I mean, I had to go in and audition, but I did get the role. So after years of knocking on the door, I'd found a different way in, landing small parts on the projects that I'd manage, including 4 more of Chris's films. Now, I continued location managing, but you know, once the cameras start rolling, it's a very different job. The creativity shifts from artistic to logistic. So instead of, do you think this architecture fits the character? It becomes, do you think this driveway fits 2 porta potties? No, I have a lot of respect for professional location managers. I mean, to be a good location manager, you have to be patient and you have to listen. Well, I got to the point where I couldn't wait to tell someone to shut up. So I left and I took a lot of what I'd learned. I started my own business where I'm an agent for people who want filming at their homes. Now, I still run into a lot of the same people that I've worked with, and in a way, I'm still scouting locations, but joyfully, it's for my own project. I came here 33 years ago with a dream of success. And it turns out that by taking several unexpected paths and being willing to let go of some things in order to pick other things up, I was able to write my own story. And even though I won't ever get to make that Academy Award-winning speech that I had imagined myself making, through a roundabout and very interesting way, I have a terrific life. And I'd like to thank all the people that made that possible. Thank you very much.
We live in a world of disappearing stories and status updates curated by a formula I've never seen before. But luckily, tonight's lineup of storytellers was not built by an algorithm, but by real people, listening to real people, listening to real people. Please welcome to the stage, Rosalinda Flores.
I wrote this poem about my grandmother's travels to the United States, the heartache of one of my friends' families who was a victim of police brutality, and my best friend's viewpoint of what it's like to be Muslim in America. This is their story, which also happens to be a chapter in mine. It all started when my granny crossed over. To be in the U.S. to celebrate the Passover, and one day, she'd be the next crossover. So watch out for the lowriders jumping over her corners. Life was hard, according to her memory. Spending anniversaries and birthdays at the cemetery, Chicanos tried to keep the culture alive because of the crazy vatos in La Calle killing our own kind. We speak accents untouched by time. We tell stories of memories through the years with our own worries to die. Fearing for the future was a pain of the past. The past led to their life's future and some never seemed to last. Roses are red, and we are brown. One thing about La Raza is that we never back down. But one thing's for sure, there is no us without trust, and in God we do trust, but trust we didn't cross the border crossed us. It all started when they began killing our brothers and sisters out there in the street, never caring to look back at the bloodstains left out on our concrete. Passing by people, exchanging smiles. They looked like the enemy, so they still got spit on their feet. Never giving off any heat, and still judged from 1979 because of the sounds of their own beat. Most in my neighborhood see their life in a glimpse. Don't press the trigger. Don't take away their life. It's not yours, it's his. Some of which have died, and some were left lucky enough to even make it to the police cruiser alive. Nowadays, you're a felon for wearing a hoodie and walking alone at night. Should we just start roaming the streets naked and cold? No, that's not right. What's up with this racial divide? How long is it gonna take until they let us try and finally fight for our own lives? It all started with a set of a different faith and belief. Why is it that when the people held responsible are killed, we get a sense of relief? I thought we all agreed that we didn't like to go through the grief. Work so hard to be proud Americans, and it turns out we're all the same. Red-blooded and still discriminated because of the pronunciation of our names. We've got to stop putting the blame on all, because that would be the wrong aim. Being struck down by all the lies, we're all losing our minds because of the tension of heat, opinions turning into facts, no justice, no peace.
I took a little field trip out to Monterey Park earlier this week just to get a feel for the area and get an idea for our location, and turns out my brother lives like right down the street, like 8 minutes away. So we popped into Garvey Nights at the Observatory and caught up with each other's lives over a 30 piece of the best chicken wings I've ever had in my life. Now, I didn't learn too much about Monterey Park because, well, chicken, but luckily, our digital assistant producer had a much more productive tour of this great city. Please welcome to the stage, to teach us about the land of which we stand, or sit, Quincy Surasmith.
Throughout the evening, we've gone on a photographic tour of Monterey Park. As we sit here at East Los Angeles College, right across the way from the Vincent Price Art Museum, let's highlight a few of the sites that make the city such a unique intersection and destination at the intersection of East LA and the San Gabriel Valley. I had the pleasure of taking photos of Monterey Park, the ones that you've seen during the show tonight, while also getting to explore the city once known as Ramona Acres. Incorporated as Monterey Park in 1916, it is bordered by the 710, the 10, and the 60. With Unheard LA, we aim to explore the complexity of the region and celebrate its diversity. There are a few places more emblematic of that than Monterey Park, as the city is known for the communities it has welcomed in, and, at times, those it has kept out. But we'll talk about that more in a bit. This was the first city in the United States to have an Asian majority. In advertising campaigns celebrating the destination to tourists in Asia, it's been hailed as the Chinese Beverly Hills. And it wasn't that long ago that Chicanos described it as the Mexican Beverly Hills. In fact, since World War II, there have also been enclaves of Japanese-American, Armenian, and Jewish communities. It was one of the few places where Japanese-Americans could buy homes upon returning from internment camps after the war. Even within the Asian-American community, Japanese-Americans and Cantonese-speaking Chinese-Americans have been joined by the Vietnamese, Khmer, Diuchu, and Mandarin-speaking folks over the years as different waves of immigrants have come to call Monterey Park their home. The name Garvey is a through line in Monterey Park's history and geography. A U.S. Army mail carrier, Richard Garvey, arrived in Los Angeles in 1859 and purchased 5,000 acres to build his home, now known as Garvey Ranch Park. His son added the adjacent fully functioning observatory in the 1930s. Around the same time, real estate developer Peter Snyder built Jardín El Encanto, now the Chamber of Commerce, and Cascades Park, wanting them to be the centerpiece of his luxury community, Midwick View Estates. The development was originally established for whites only, but spoiler alert, its surrounding neighborhoods grew to become the richly diverse city we're sitting in today. It's pretty much impossible to come to Monterey Park and not mention the food. Places like Ocean Star, Elite, and NBC Seafood all compete to be the top dim sum spot. And I personally have a weakness for Mama Lou's and Cook's Tortas. Of course, Monterey Park first made its mark on the culinary scene in the 1920s when Laura Scudder started her potato chip empire at a service station on the southwest corner of Garvey and Atlantic. Immigration has shaped the city over the decades, in particular the many Latino and Asian communities that have come to call Monterey Park their home. It's a transformation that's reflected in storefront signs, the makeup of classrooms at local schools, and even on this very campus at East LA College. The city continues to grow and flourish as it remembers its motto, pride in the past, faith in the future. In the meantime, I'm glad to appreciate where we are, here and now.
That's a team right there. You know, sometimes it's the scent of your mom's cooking. Other times it's that gnome in your grandparents' front yard, or that big tree on the corner, or that last turn onto your block. We all have our own ways of recognizing home. Here to share hers, please welcome Raina Victoria.
I fell in love for the first time when I was 15 years old. My dad was driving us along the 10 freeway, away from my grandparents' house on the west side, toward Idlewild for camp. That's when I saw it, the downtown LA skyline. I had never seen anything so beautiful in all my life. It spiraled to the heavens, contrasting against the bright blue summer sky. Growing up in quiet, suburban Thousand Oaks, I had never encountered anything so alive. We'd visit my grandparents' house on the west side regularly, their Spanish-style duplex on Crescent Heights with its hexagon tiles and tacky pink bathtub, always made me feel safe. They eventually moved to Beverly Hills, and the palm trees that greeted us filled my veins with excitement. But when I saw that LA skyline, in that moment, I knew that this was the shape of my heart. When I finally figured out how to drive at 17, I would do anything to see it. Thousand Oaks was my prison, where I was too voluptuous, too loud, too opinionated, too much. LA was my jungle gym. I'd explore obscure areas, driving as far as my car could take me, feeling at peace in almost every neighborhood I visited. But my favorite activity was curling up underneath the awnings of the Griffith Observatory, writing in my notebook, gazing lovingly at that skyline. Around the time the observatory closed for renovations, I moved to Orange County to finish college. I would drive up regularly to see my parents and grandparents. But no matter how long I lived behind the orange curtain, a thrill would course over my body when I would see that skyline. But in Orange County, I found friendship, loyalty, and much cleaner beaches. It was also a lot easier to date. At 22, I started dating a guy who, 2 months in, told me he was going to marry me. I should have been thrilled, but it made me feel trapped. However, it was also better than going back to Thousand Oaks. As our relationship continued, I was pushed farther and farther away from that Los Angeles skyline. I would see it from far away, glances in the distance as I was driving to work. If he wasn't around, I could get closer, particularly when running errands on Sunday mornings along Pico Boulevard. It was always nice to be home again. If I were going up to LA with him, he would be driving. He told me regularly that I was a horrible driver. He'd throw terrifying tantrums in traffic and swear we would never move here. Even if I took him on the metro to downtown, he'd always find a reason to complain about the city. Throughout the years, he would scream and throw fits when things weren't exactly the way he wanted. He would bang his hands on the cabinets and threaten suicide. When we argued, he'd say, "This is why it will never work between us." Or, "See, unlike you, I live in reality." That wasn't his favorite comeback, though. That was reserved for, "You could never live without me." A little less than a year before we were going to start a family, I saw him screaming and noisily running his hands along the blinds of our Costa Mesa living room. This was his reaction over not paying a bill exactly when he wanted me to. Yet all I could see in my mind was him, frightening my unborn daughter as she cowered in a corner. That's when I decided to try to live without him. He threatened to kill himself, to hurt me. When I said I wanted a divorce, he responded, "I don't care if you love me or not. I am never letting you go." On a cold January night, I drove into the darkness carrying very little, a red duffel bag of clothing, a prayer book, a photo of my now deceased grandparents, and the traveler's prayer on my lips as I approached the orange fluorescent lights of the 405. For 6 months, I tried to make my life in Orange County again, but I soon realized the pain was too great. My 30th birthday party was also my goodbye party, an evening that I jokingly referred to as the last night on earth. I returned to my parents' house in Thousand Oaks, arriving on their doorstep empty. No job, no relationship, little money, and few friends. I was tired from the fight. I didn't even know where to begin my life again. But I did have a car. One weekday in July, when everyone else was at work, I decided to take that drive, winding up the Griffith Park Mountains to the observatory. It was just as beautiful as I remembered it. Bright blue sky, with the awnings overlooking my first love, the downtown skyline. The wind ran its fingers through my hair, as if saying, "Welcome home, Reign of Victoria. The jungle loves you. You're beautiful." Standing on that awning, I had no idea what my future would bring, nor all the hardships I would endure. My belly didn't know true hunger yet. My heart had no idea about real heartbreak, and my soul wasn't done being tested. But the foundation for my survival, the perseverance to move forward, was laid out in that minute. This place could give me the anonymity to grieve what I had lost and the strength to create something even better. I would live for myself, for my city, Los Angeles, my first love, my home. I was now ready to face the unknown because I had come to heaven to live amongst the angels. Since that January night, it has been 6 years, 6 months, and 15 days. He said I could never live without him. I hope he knows I am very much alive.
Woo! Now, I know you're all just meeting today, and you've done a great job so far. I'm gonna remind you one more time to play nice. It can be hard to find community in a new place. Everyone has their own little clique. All the lunch tables are all taken up at lunch, and you just get used to people butchering your last name. Until now, hopefully. Please welcome to the stage Monterey Park's own Oscar Sagastume.
He did a good job. I grew up in Monterey Park. I went to Repetto Elementary and then Mark Keppel High, and I never fit in because I looked like that. I mean, come on. All right, take it off. But man, did I try. I did try, and I, when I was a child, came up with the brilliant idea to join the hall monitors to make friends. It sucked. Because I was a militant hall monitor. And I was the Genghis Khan of the hallways. When my older sister saw how terrible and desperate I was, she told me that when I joined her in high school, I should follow her lead, and so I did. She had me join the band, the theater department, and La Raza. This was an organization that celebrated Latin culture, and I knew my parents would want me to be part of this because they really wanted me to get in touch with my Guatemalan background. A little backstory. My family moved to Los Angeles from Guatemala when I was 2 years old, and when I was 5, my mother noticed something. When she would call out to me, I wouldn't respond. And then when she would talk to me, my eyes would glaze over, and my parents feared the worst. They took me to a hearing specialist, and he ran a bunch of tests on me. After the tests were done, he called my parents into his office, and I remember he sat behind this really big black desk. He took off his glasses and he cleaned them. He said, "I know why you're having issues with your son." And I looked over and I saw my parents grab each other's hands, bracing for the news. He took a deep breath and he said, "He doesn't understand Spanish." Yeah, he only speaks English, so you need to speak English to him. You see, my parents wanted me to be an American and speak good. I mean well. And when we moved here, my sister, when she started going to school, she was placed in an ESL class. And my folks had to take an English class, actually, at Mark Keppel High. And I remember going with them when I was a kid, and the teacher would be going over American idioms while I was playing on the floor with my toys. And my parents didn't want me to suffer through those classes, so they pushed me to be American and speak English. We didn't have any money for your fancy tutors, so they plopped me down in front of America's tutors, Big Bird and Mr. Rogers. And I acclimated, and a little too well for their liking. They wanted me to act Hispanic, but I was American. Like many immigrants, my parents moved to a city to be close to other Hispanic people. And in the early 80s, Monterey Park was mostly Hispanic. And as I grew up here, trying to fit in, the city shifted from a Hispanic populace to an Asian populace. And my parents' idea of cultural comfort in this city disappeared. The city didn't know who it was, which made going to a school that was also powering through growing pains very challenging. Having a mixed ethnic population was difficult for the teachers to handle. I had one teacher, though, that would lament that the school was much better off with white children, like God intended. And she would tell us, in class, repeatedly. But that casual racism didn't bother me, but the air of a racial... It didn't. But the air of a racial divide makes it hard to make friends. Not a lot of kids had much in common with each other. Sure, we all watched the same cartoons and TV shows, but really, TV was our only shared experience. Heck, we wouldn't even say the same thing when someone sneezed. So I was stuck in this weird sort of limbo. I wasn't like any of the other kids. I wasn't Chinese, Japanese, or Korean. I mean, obviously. And other like Hispanic kids would call me a coconut because I was brown on the outside and white in the middle. I wasn't Hispanic enough to them. And I wasn't like the normal kid. I mean, I loved Borscht Belt comedy. And I also got way too many references when I watched The Golden Girls. And I watched The Golden Girls. I mean, I couldn't wait for high school. I mean, things would have to be better, right? Which leads me back to the group La Raza. We met during lunch and we would eat together. And I hadn't really sat with anyone during lunch for years. Normally I opted to eat alone in the library because I hated how lonely it felt to eat at a table built to hold 8 people. As much as I didn't fit in with the La Raza kids, I stayed because being alone was harder. I wasn't really even bullied in school. I was bullied in school. I was just invisible. And La Raza was happy to have me because of the color of my skin. As long as you were brown, you were welcome. When I was a sophomore, 2 things happened. One, my friend in La Raza got a girlfriend of Chinese descent, and this guy named Raul joined the group. When my buddy got his girlfriend, she started coming to the meetings and offered to take notes and help out. She would sit in the back next to my friend, happy to be near him, and Raul did not like this. He didn't think it was right. Raul thought that the group was only for brown people, so he called a secret meeting. Raul wanted to kick out my friend's girlfriend. To my surprise, a bunch of other people agreed, and it made me angry. I didn't see what the big deal. She wasn't doing anything. She was just there. She was part of the club. She was just hanging out with her boyfriend. And she was nice, and she came out to support us. Raul wouldn't listen to reason, so I left the group in a huff, vowing never to return. But because my sister was still part of the group and my parents wanted me to return to La Raza's loving embrace, I had to go to this stupid fundraising dinner. And at this dinner, with all these people that decided not to stand up to Raul's crazy divide, and they were all there enjoying a meal that my buddy's girlfriend had helped set up, prior to getting kicked out, it just made me mad. I mean, if I was old enough to drink, I would have been drinking, but I wasn't. So instead, I just stared at Raul, trying to decide what I was going to say to him, what I was going to do. And then at one point toward the end of the night, Raul came to talk to me. And in English, he told me how sorry he was that I left and that La Raza would always welcome me back. Then he turned to some other member and in Spanish started to tell her that I was a traitor to Hispanics and that he was only making nice because of my sister. But deep down, I would always be a fat coconut. He laughed but stopped when he saw the look on my face because even though I couldn't speak Spanish, my parents had made sure that I understood it. And Raul did not know this until then. When he tried to backtrack in English, I raised my hand and I told him to stop, and I told him that I understood what he said, and then I said, things. A language I cannot repeat because this might end up on the radio someday, but they were bad words, lots of bad words. And I wasn't eloquent, I was just angry. And then I left in a huff, but I didn't drive, so I just walked out to the parking lots. And waited by my parents' car at Baker Square at night. La Raza was the first place that had welcomed me blindly, and it was a group of people that looked like me and accepted me. It hurt to be separated, but I felt betrayed, and I couldn't be part of a group that only cared about what I looked like on the outside instead of who I was on the inside. Thank you.
Young people change the world. I mean, take a look at all the pivotal moments in our history. Who fights wars on the front lines? Who's out in the streets trying to be heard? Today's youth are more aware than ever, and if we listen to them, perhaps, just maybe, we might just be all right. Please welcome to the stage, Violeta Esquivel.
Parents are being split from their children every day. They have been labeled terrorists, drug dealers, and murderers. When they are detained, they are sent to a detention center, which is normally a maximum security jail facility. Deportation is a life-changing trauma for these families. I know firsthand because I will never forget September 3rd, 2015. It was a scorching hot day, the kind of heat that would not ease up. I was 9 years old and I had just started the fourth grade. I was excited because I was sporting my new Betsy Johnson backpack in pink and a big bow. This poem is titled, I Faked a Smile. This is dedicated to mi gente or those who don't understand how immigration affects a child. I faked a smile. Kids do it all the time without being told. They call Los Angeles a sanctuary city. But one day, there was a harsh knock on my door. It pounded and shook our tiny studio apartment. There they were, five or six policemen, green vests, letters ICE stitched across their backs. ICE, Immigration and Custom Enforcement. La Migra, guns and unmarked black car just like the movies. At the door, they asked for someone else, a different guy, a different name. My mom says, he doesn't live here. We don't know him. Ma'am, can you let us confirm this? They asked in their serious voice. My mom and I held hands, crying in the middle of the street. I never knew how long and deep my street was until this day. At school, we are scared. My friends and I live in fear. How can we learn Common Core when the core of our hearts are breaking? I cannot imagine my life without him. He is my stepfather. I call him Beto. To me, he is el Chavo del Ocho, el Loco, el Gordito, el Beethoven, el que se cree el muy, tú sabes. But now he is known as A2057-12204. A stands for alien, belonging to a foreign country or nation, an illegal alien. He was taken away early that morning for an unpaid parking ticket from 2006. No time left, we did not say goodbye. I held back the tears all day and I faked a smile. Now when I visit him, he wears a lime green jumper. My hand is small, his is big. The glass is cold between our hands. When families are torn apart by borders and laws, it hurts. When you take our people away, it hurts. I have a question for you, Mr. President. Una pregunta. In addition to corn, dairy, labor, and música, why can't we start to export education, love, compassion, solutions, educación, amor, soluciones, like a plus sign that adds to, instead of a division line, complicated and long? Why can't the border be a line of love?
We have been some places today. So now we're friends, all right? That's building community. And it can happen anywhere, especially when you have great comic timing. Please welcome to the stage our closer, Brian Kett.
When I feel lonely, I go for long walks. And my first year living in Los Angeles, I walked so much that I had to resole my shoes twice. I'm from Chicago, and back in Chicago, I know tons of people. But out here, I hardly knew anyone. And what made things even more difficult was that I worked from home, writing medical brochures about Botox and catheters. And some days my biggest human interaction would be when I would hear my neighbors through the walls, and I could never really be sure if they were fighting or celebrating. And so when my landlord dropped off my lease to be renewed for the following year, I was hesitant because I missed people. And I decided that I needed a sign, some sort of human connection to convince me to stay here. And so I left my apartment for the day and I went to work from a coffee shop. And at the coffee shop, I tried to engage with the barista and I said, "Hey man, what kind of pastry is your favorite?" Really, really A-plus material. And he just stared at me. He gave me no response. And so I picked out a croissant that sucked. And I sat down next to this woman who was working on her laptop. And when I asked her if I could share the electrical outlet that she was using, it was like I was asking her for a kidney. There was so much disdain, and it was then and there that I said that I was done with Los Angeles. And so for the next 5 hours, I just sat there in silence, and I wrote about how catheters can cause bacterial infections. At the end of the day, I packed up, and I walked over to the Albertsons in my neighborhood, because writing about catheters and bacterial infections reminded me that I was out of shower soap at home. So I headed over to Albertsons, and Albertsons was slammed. Everybody in Los Feliz was shopping there. And it was so crowded, it took me so long to even get back to where the shower soap was, that by the time I did, I was really, really worked up. And I decided that I deserved a treat, damn it. And so I picked up some chocolate milk, because I'm an adult. And I went to the checkout line, I set down the soap next to the milk, and there was this woman in front of me who had really big hair. And she turned around, she looked at me and what I was buying, and she kind of scoffed. And I knew why. It's because if you buy one thing, that's an errand, right? But if you buy two things, everybody assumes you're somehow going to use both of those items concurrently. And she just gave me this real nasty look, like she just knew I was going to go home and drink the milk when I was all lathered up in the shower. like some sort of pervert. And so I just pushed her out of my mind. I thought about how I was going to pack up my apartment when someone behind me in line tapped me on the shoulder. And I turned around to find the oldest woman in Los Angeles. She had a face like a dried apple. And she was wearing a plastic babushka on her head, even though it hadn't rained in like months. And she was saying something I couldn't quite make out as she was unloading vegetables that I had never even seen before, never even heard of. And I didn't really want to talk to her. But there was a businessman in line behind her, and I tried to engage with him through her. I gave him a look that said, like, this lady, am I right? And he gave me no response. He gave me the old barista treatment. And so before I turned away from her, I kind of realized, you know what? Here's a person who wants to engage with you. Maybe she has something to say. Hear her out. And I said, excuse me, ma'am? And I realized she was saying, how do you cook the dinosaurs? And I thought, damn it. But then she continued. She said, if my grandchildren don't want these, I do not want to waste them. And from her cart, she pulled out a small plush stegosaurus and a small plush Tyrannosaurus Rex that she got in the toy aisle. And she set them down next to her vegetables. And she said, so how do you cook these? She wasn't just the oldest woman in Los Angeles. She was the most adorable person in Los Angeles. I said, you know what, ma'am? Normally, I broil my brontosaurus. And she lit up. And she let out this great laugh that sounded like clucking. But that's when it happened. The big-haired woman in front of us overheard us interacting. The big-haired woman leaned over, and the big-haired woman said, last week, Velociraptor was on special. It was delicious. So now the three of us are in this human moment out of nowhere, and then the businessman chimes in. He comes to life, he leans forward, and he says, you know, normally I deep fry my dinosaurs, even though I am certain it isn't good for me. And so the four of us are in this moment, and it's real, and it's human, and it's everything. And then the cashier cleared his throat, because the big-haired woman had to pay. We all snapped to attention. Our fun was over. But then the cashier slowly leaned across the conveyor belt and said, the Albertsons brand of dinosaur is the tastiest brand of dinosaur because the Albertsons brand of dinosaur comes with its own stuffing. And everyone broke out into these smiles. And so the big hair woman paid and she left, and then I paid for my soap and my milk that I wasn't going to do anything perverted with. And I turned to the old woman, I said, I really hope you enjoy your dinosaurs if your grandchildren don't. And she beamed at me. And I left there really feeling like I was a part of something larger. Because that human connection, it's all around us, right? It's even more not looking for it. It's even in grocery store checkout lines. And it's even here in Los Angeles. And so I went home and I took a shower with soap. And then afterwards, I poured myself a big glass of chocolate milk, and then I sat down, and I re-signed my lease.
And that's our show. Can we get all of our storytellers back on stage? Everybody, come on back up.
We're up here to share those stories that too often go unheard, and to show the magic that happens when we stop and listen to each other. We want to listen to you. How'd you like tonight's show? You can let us know by texting UnheardLA to 63735. Check your spelling. Don't let autocorrect get the best of you. Answer those two questions. You help us get better and help us make a case for more UnheardLA. Thank you to John Cohn, Ashley Alvarado, and the rest of the KPCC in-person team today, Justin Baker, Nathaniel Beaver, Caitlin Bujan, Charlotte Duran, Tony Federico, Louis Felix, Daphne Liu, Valentino Rivera, Quincy Sura-Smith, Bill Youngblood, and Liz Zimmerman. Also, our team includes interns brand new for this year. Come here for Isara Aceves, Natalie El High, Denise Kathy Guerrero, and Jane Jesevowitz. And many thanks to today's volunteers, Julie Carley, Tina Livingstone, Mo Jazzy, Annie Ramon, and Shelley Scanlon. Also, thank you to Quetzal for use of his track Unbound, Sweltos from the album The Eternal Get Down. Thank you to our growing Unheard LA family, the folks here at East LA College, and to the California Wellness Foundation and California Humanities for supporting this project, which continues in August in Lawndale, in September in Long Beach. Show dates and details at kpcc.org/unheardla. And once again, thank you for coming out. Stick around for the mixer, where I encourage you to meet someone new, tell them where you're from, and whatever you do, do not leave here tonight with your story unheard. Have a good night. Bless you.